Yes. Turn to the book of Matthew and let's look at God's Word. If you don't have the Bible, doesn't matter. I'll read it for you. But if you have, good. It's good to have God's Word in your hands. The book of Matthew. The first book in the New Testament. And if you're planning to study the Bible, the first book you need to start with will be Matthew. Matthew is a great book. Then go all the way down. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Book of Acts, all the way down to Revelation. Then you go to the Old Testament. Matthew chapter 7, verses 7-11. Is it remember? 7-11. That is 7. Chapter 7, verses 7-11. These powerful verses. Is it to remember the reference? Okay, do you remember the reference? Is it for you to find? Matthew 7, 7-11. Go back and do research when studying these verses. And the Word of God says, everybody say Word of God.
Word of God.
When you say Word of God, make sure you respect it. It's God's Word, so it's not a fairy tale, it's not newspaper, not Facebook, but God's Word, Firman Tuhan. So you must hormat. So it's God's Word. When you read God's Word, we have to have a different attitude. Different attitude. You read Facebook, okay, lepak, tak apa, lepak. But Firman Tuhan, jangan lepak. Firman Tuhan, you have to be serious. Okay, with the right heart. Ask, and it will be given to you. You want to say ask.
Ask.
Hello friend, you got to ask. You got to ask. You got to start asking. When was the last time you asked God to bless you? When was the last time you asked God to bless your marriage? When was the last time you asked God to protect your children? When was the last time you asked God to heal you? You got to ask. We have to ask. We have to be active. Ask means active. Don't just tell me you're busy asking your boss, asking your staff, the people above you, the people under you, do this, do that, or give me increment. That's all you ask. But God, we don't ask. We often fear. That's why it's important to ask God. It doesn't stop there. God is not satisfied for you to ask. He says, seek, and you will find. Everyone says, seek.
Seek.
Again, ask is being active. Seek is being active. We have to ask. We have to seek. Cari. And then, it doesn't stop there. We ask. You know, 3 is the number of completion. Who can say amen?
Amen.
God is speaking about pleading from Him completely. 1 time is not enough. 2 times. 3 times, but 3 times, the number 3 in the Bible means complete. Like Father, Son, Holy Spirit. How many days Jesus died in the grave before He rose up? How many days was He in the grave? 3 days. He rested completely, then He got up. 3 in the Bible means complete. So Jesus is asking us to pray completely. Ask, seek, and then knock. Everyone say knock.
Knock.
And it will be open to you. You got to pray completely with us. Ask, seek, and knock. In other words, don't give up praying. How many of you have had a prayer or a desire in your life and you prayed for so long and you say, God's not going to answer? You're not sure if God's going to answer. If there's, God answers our prayers in 3 ways. Everyone say 3 ways. Listen up. But whatever ways God chooses is always good for us. And whichever way God chooses for us to answer us, He will make it clear to you. If you're not sure what God is saying, let's say if Judith is praying for her husband. Let's say if Deacon Judith is praying for her husband. If God doesn't want you to get married, He will make it clear to you that you are called to be single. So if you're not clear, it's your job to keep on praying. Are you listening? Come on, are you listening?
Yes.
So you have to be clear. God is not. God is. God have perfect speech. Who can say amen?
Amen.
Like you and I, we speak. Our speech not. But God speak. His speech is perfect. When He speaks, it's clear. Who can say amen?
Amen.
When you pray, God answers 3 ways. Either say yes. Doesn't mean you everything you ask God will say yes. He's the perfect father. Are you listening?
Yeah.
If my daughter, now she's 11 years old, she says, Papa, I want a car. Will I give her a car?
No.
If I give her a car, means I'm a stupid father. I'm a borrow father. So God is the same. God will not say yes to everything you ask. But God will not simply say no. Do you understand?
Yeah.
I might simply say no because I'm an earthly father. He's a heavenly father. He says yes means yes is good for you. He says no means no is good for you. And the third answer is hold on. So when you pray, God will either say yes or no or hold on. But if you are not getting any of these three, don't assume it's a no. Don't assume it's a hold on. Are you listening? Yeah. If you're not clear what God is saying, I don't know whether it's yes or no, means your job is to keep on praying as Ephesians 6:18 says. Tell your friend beside you, your job is to keep on praying. Go on. Your job is to keep on praying. So don't assume it's a hold on answer. Don't assume it's a no answer. Okay? You have to keep on praying. That's why it says, ask, seek, knock. God speaks so much about prayer. You know, even Jesus prayed. Come on. Even Jesus prayed. Don't lift your hands up. Honestly, tell to yourself, how many of you, Dickon Judith already, I think three or four times, and Mike has mentioned, HSI, every Friday, pray 11 p.m. How many of you have prayed? Don't leave your hands up, please. I'll be ashamed for you. The announcement has been going on every Sunday. 11 o'clock, pray from wherever you are. How many of you busy playing bingo? How many of you busy watching TV? How many of you busy young child, your friend? How many of you doing this and busy sleeping? We have no time to pray, but we have time for all kinds of things. He says, God, you never bless me, but we don't do what God is calling us to do. We pick what's convenient for us in God's word. We hiraukan other parts which we don't feel comfortable. That praying and time. Praying is not my style. I'm not good in praying. No. The Bible says, if you're a child of God, you pray. Who can say amen?
Amen.
Say amen.
Amen.
Everyone is called to ask, seek, and knock. Not just Pastor Ed. Not just Pastor Amanda. Everyone. And God is not calling you to have perfect prayers. So you can have the worst English. You pray, God, as long as you pray in your heart, your prayer comes from here. God is excited. Who can say amen? Come on.
Amen.
But don't forget, next time you think, why ask? Then seek, then knock. Because God is telling you, you must really pray. You must really seek God. We must seek God. Today's generation, we are not seeking God enough. My wife and I went for a marriage retreat 1 month ago. Or 2-3 weeks ago? 1 month, I think about 1 month ago. We went to just three couples only. In this like a resort like that, all pastors and their wives and pastors. So one thing that we made a few decisions from the retreat, and one of the decisions is, because though I always pray, she always pray, but we don't pray together. So in that retreat, the Holy Spirit spoke to both of us. It says you both need to also pray together because you are one, husband and wife. The Bible says you become one, two become one, not mother and child. To become one is not mother and daughter, whatever. To become is husband and wife. So we made that promise. So we have been quite faithful, 90% since we came on retreat. Every night at 11 o'clock sharp, husband and wife, we pray together. That's one of the things we do. But I still pray on my own and she prays on her own. Because we know how serious it is to pray. Tell your friend beside you, start praying today. Come on. Start praying today. And on Friday at 11 o'clock, pray together. You may encourage us at least you know that. You know, do you know this? On Friday, 11 o'clock, people all over the world are praying with this church. This HSI is not just our church, you know. I have friends in Africa praying at that time, Malaysian time. In America, in Philippines, in Indonesia, in Singapore, and people all over the world are praying at 11 o'clock Malaysian time. This is something the Holy Spirit has led me to start. I started this about 2 years ago, and I've been faithful doing this from 2 years ago. Every Friday, 11, even where I am, I'll do my best to remember to pray. So you can pray also. There is a reason to pray. Every Friday, not just every Friday, but every day of your life. You don't have to be very, I don't know how to pray, my praying is not so good. Don't think that way. That is the lie of the devil. You can pray like a little child. Just pray. Just praying, he's just talking to God. I said, God, I love you. God, please help my family. God, please protect me. That's prayer. That's prayer. God, heal my leg. My leg is so pain, la. Heal my leg, God. Jesus, heal my leg, la. You can use la, so it doesn't matter. Praying is like that. Just simple. Don't have to go, oh God, you have to heal my family, God. La, 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 la. Whatever it is. Not it. Just simple. Just pray. In fact, God loves simple prayers. Who can say amen?
Amen.
God don't care about your English. Like some people, they like to correct people's English. Okay, God don't care about that. So you just pray only. Daddy God desires a two-way street. One of the reasons why you want us to pray. Some of us think, why you want us to pray? You're so powerful and so good. You just give me the good things now. You just bless me. Why you must ask and ask? You know why? Because God is desiring a relationship. So when we start to ask, then we are going to God and then God responds, that two-way street. God is not for a one-way street relationship. How does the wife feel when the wife only talks to her husband, doesn't talk to the wife? That's one-way street. Because God always used marriage as an example that to describe His relationship with us. He is the husband and we are the wives. Who can say amen? Who can say amen?
Amen.
God is the husband and we are the wives.
Yes,
I always tell people, you cannot have, God don't want you to have more than one. If you take God as your husband, means you only have God alone. I want God, but I want this, I want that. No, God and God alone. If you have loved God and you love money the same, that means you have two husbands. Understand? If God is here and money is here, God is this important and money, that means you have two husbands. It is idolatry. You have God Jesus here, you have Buddha here, it is idolatry. You love Jesus and you also love your job the same. It is idolatry that you have two husbands. Anything can become idol, not just a religion, not just a statue, but anything. So everything in your life is go down and Jesus come up, Jesus come up, Jesus come all the way up. And that's where Jesus really become your heavenly husband. You can say amen.
Amen.
But just the same way, He's your spouse. He is His perfect spouse. He wants the communication. We ask Him for blessings. Then He gives us the blessing. And we say, thank you for the blessing. And we ask Him more other things and He gives us, thank you. There's communication. So one of the major reasons why God wants us to pray is because of relationship. Amen. And when God blesses you, don't forget to be grateful. If God has healed you, don't forget to be grateful. If God helped you in your career, God helped you in your marriage, God protected you from an accident like He did yesterday. He protected me from an accident yesterday. Be grateful. Thank you, God, and tell people, my God saved me. My God healed me. My God blessed me. My God changed me. And His name is Jesus. You can say amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So one of the major reasons why God wants us to pray is because of relationship. Relationship. God can just give us all that we need without asking Him. But God said, no, I want a relationship. That's why God put us on this earth. Relationship. What else? I married to my wife, how many years already? 19 years, I'm around there. 19 years already. And we talk a lot to each other. She tells me things, I tell her things. We talk a lot. And that's why our relationship is wonderful. I won't say perfect, but we have a wonderful relationship. What type of relationship? I think I would have heard a divorce if I married her, but she doesn't talk to me. I don't want that kind of marriage. In a marriage, in a relationship, there must be two way. Amen? That's why you need to pray. Don't forget to pray. Ask, seek, and knock. And God will answer. Say amen.
Amen.
Let me read that. Let me finish with reading Matthew 7:7, 7:8. Come on. If you have the Bible, turn to your Bible. Matthew 7:8. For everyone who asks, say everyone.
Everyone.
Not some. Huh? This is talking about all of this. Is talking about God's children. Sesiapa saja di antara anak-anak Tuhan yang minta akan terima. Sesiapa saja. Everyone, semua orang. Setiap orang anak Tuhan yang minta akan terima. Verse 8. For everyone who asks, receives. And and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks it will be opened. Verse 9. Or what man is there among you who, if his son asks for bread, you will give him a stone? Number 10. Or if your child asks you for a fish, you will give him a snake? Verse 11. If you then, being evil, speaking to us, earthly father, you are evil, we are all evil, humans are evil, you know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your father? Everyone say, will.
Will.
Say again, will.
Will.
Will means he will. If you continue to pray, God will answer you. But you have to pray, ask, seek, and knock. Means continuously. And I said earlier, don't simply assume God is saying no. Unless God clearly, if God says no, he will give you clear answer. It's no. And if God says hold on, he will tell you clearly, hold on. Don't just assume. Don't make up an S out of you and not out of God. Huh? Assume, A-S-S, to make an S. Okay, out of you and him. Don't just make sure, you just come to pray until you get, he's telling me to wait, I'm not ready yet. Or he's telling me no, that's not good for me. He's telling me yes, he gave, and you get green light to say. Verse 9. We read that, sorry. Verse 11. Let's do 11. If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father, not maybe, but will, it's a definite word, will your Father who is in heaven give good things? Everyone say good things.
Good things.
Yes, whatever God gives is good. If God says no to you, Sharon, that is good. If God says yes to you, that is also good. If God says hold on to you, Sharon, that's also good. And if you call him God, you allow him to decide. Who can say amen?
Yes.
You decide, let him decide. Oh, let's say I want this, let's say you are Jerry is single. I want that girl. But God says no. Why no? You don't understand. Doesn't matter, you understand or you don't understand. If God says no, means no. Means she's not good for you. Amen? So God knows. So don't try to be smarter than God. He is smarter than you a billion times. Not just smarter than you and I, but smarter than us a billion times. Let's turn to Matthew chapter 17. Let's go 10 words of 10 chapters later. So we talk about prayer, we establish that prayer is necessary, but what comes with prayer? Berdoa sahaja tak cukup. Sekarang kita lihat, bersama dengan doa, kita juga mesti mempunyai iman. Okay. Matthew 17, 19 to 20, the word of God says, then the disciples came to Jesus privately and said, this is a situation where the disciples tried to do something, but they didn't succeed. They said, how come we did this, cannot succeed? And Jesus answered them. Look, then the disciples came to Jesus privately and asked, why could we not cast it out? Verse 20, so Jesus said to them, because of your unbelief. Everyone say unbelief.
Unbelief.
So when you pray, you must believe. Belief means faith. Iman, pray, faith. You need to have faith. Tell your friends like you have to have faith. Come on. You have to have faith. Not enough to pray. Blah, 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 blah. Oh God, heal me. But you don't believe. You never get healed. Oh God, give me a good wife. But you don't believe that God's going to give you a good wife. You will never get a good wife. In other words, prayer from here is useless. Prayer has to come from here. Say amen. Prayer comes from here. You can pray. You can pray from morning to night from here. Your prayer is going nowhere. It's in the scriptures. Your prayer has to come from here. Tell your friend, pray with faith. Come on. Pray with faith. Pray with faith. Believe. Believe that the Almighty God, the most loving God, not just most loving, most powerful God, is hearing you out. Hallelujah. Verse 20. So Jesus said to them, because of your unbelief, for surely I say to you, if you have faith as a mustard seed, and faith there is no size. Some of the old mustard seed. Do you know that the mustard seed is the smallest seed in the whole wide world? Okay, the mustard seed is the smallest seed. And the smallest seed produces the biggest trees on this planet. The mustard tree is a big, big tree. Are you listening?
Yeah.
There is no size in faith. What Jesus is saying is actually, when he says, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, means it's easy to have faith. Just believe. If I were to tell Balan, Balan, I love you.
No.
No, I love you as a brother, not as a lover. If I say, Balan, I love you. Listen. So it's Balan's choice to believe whether I love him or not. Are you listening?
Yes.
So no, I can be the nicest guy on planet Earth. I can be doing all kinds of nice things to him, but yet he can choose not to believe that I love him. Get it? So Jesus could be doing so many things for all of us, but yet, at the end of the day, many of us are ungrateful and we choose to believe that I'm not sure he can answer that prayer. I'm not sure he's going to listen to my prayer. We may not say it, but deep inside, many of us have this problem. We trust people. We trust the rich man more than Jesus. We trust our bosses more. We trust our hard work more than Jesus. We trust speakers, good speakers, the motivational speakers more than Jesus. We have to have faith. I look at your face, I can tell all of you have problems. Different kinds of problems. Tell your friend, I know you have a problem. Come on. I know you have a problem. None of us, even believe me, we all have problems. We all have it. And the good news is, if we pray with faith, God can solve this problem. You can say amen. And when this problem goes away, new problems are going to come. That's life. This is not heaven, this is earth. This is not heaven. Heaven is where problem free. But you're on this earth, you solve one problem, God solves for you, new problems arise. And then when these problems with challenges, you grow, you get stronger, you get wiser, you get sharper. Amen? But you need to pray with faith. I've seen lots of miracles in my life, I've seen lots of miracles in many people's life that I pray for. When we pray in faith. Hallelujah, thank you Jesus. Say thank you Jesus.
Thank you Jesus.
Okay, let's continue with that at first. Verse 20. So Jesus said to them, because of your unbelief, I say to you, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you will say this mountain. Mountain here is not talking about mountain, it's a figurative speech. Mountain speaks about even the most difficult thing can be solved. Amen. The most difficult problem, even that scientifically proven, says that AIDS cannot be cured. If God wants to cure AIDS, why not? Who can say amen?
Amen?
But if you drill in your head, science says that cannot means cannot. The Bible says what is impossible with men is possible with God. Who can say amen?
Amen.
But some people just refuse to believe that. Even as simple as they cannot forgive, like what is you must forgive. But they say, I cannot forgive. So I forgive that person, the advantage of me. But God says, you must forgive. But they trust their own knowledge. They trust their own instinct. They all trust their own logic. Instead of trusting God. We have to trust God in everything that He says. That God says it's better to give than to receive. Who can say amen? Easy to say amen. Do you practice it or not? God says it's better to give than to receive. But logically, if I give, I have less. Logically speaking, if you give, you have less. If I have $10 and I give Lucy $2, I have $8 now. Why is that better? Having $10 better than having $8 one. Then I give Helen $2 more, I have $6. But the Bible says it's better to give than to receive. I'm having less now, why is it better? But if God says it's better, means it's better. Who can say amen?
Amen.
Not logic. Logic, I have six. How can $6 be better than 10? But God says it's better to give than to receive. If God says it's better, means it's better. That's faith. Say amen.
Amen.
So not logic, not common sense, not knowledge comes before God. God comes before everything. Because everything is under the feet of Jesus. Including the greatest intelligence. That's why we call him God. We don't call scientists God. We call them scientists here. But we call Jesus God here. Amen.
Amen.
So let's have faith. And do you know that we all practice faith? All of you sitting on the chair right now. Are you sure the chair is going to hold you? The reason you are sitting on that chair simply means that you have faith in that chair. Are you following? If I don't have faith in this chair, because I have faith in this chair, I sit down, I put my butt down, and sit comfortably. If I don't have faith in this chair, I'll be like, okay, we check 10 times, then okay, put slowly down, follow. But none of you did that. You came to the church, boom, you put your butt down. Because you have faith in that chair. So don't tell me it's difficult to have faith. You can even have faith on a chair. So why can't you have faith in God? Are you listening?
Yes.
None of you totally understand how does a phone work. None of you are that genius. But you know that you click the... We just dial this number and it's, hey, hi Alex, how are you? But nobody understands how does my voice from here can get to Alex who is in India right now? So far away, but my voice from here can reach there. Come on, anything can explain to me how it happens, but you just have faith in the phone, that's why you just use it. Hello? My point here is, we all practice faith every single day. So don't tell me it's hard to have faith in God. You have faith in the phone, you have faith. You have faith, you have faith in a lot of things. You and I. Are you listening?
Yes.
So it's not difficult to have faith in God. Tell your friend, it's not difficult to have faith in God. Come on. It's not difficult to have faith in God. Blessed are those who believe yet they have not seen. Blessed are those who believe yet they have not seen. Why you believe in this chair? Because I saw it. She sat down, she didn't fall. So I sat down. Oh, the person call and they can reach to England, I can call. Because we see. We saw. But with God, probably we have not seen Him, not touched Him, not smelled Him, not heard Him. Difficult to have faith. But God says, unless you have faith like little children. I tell you, you give Asher another 2 years when he can walk. Huh? And mommy, Elena takes him to a high hill. Elena says, darling boy, jump! Asher will jump. Because Asher has faith in his mother. That's the meaning of having faith like a little child. But if God tells you to jump, will you jump? If God tells me, Edmund, go to India and be the next Mother Teresa, will I go? I pray I will. I pray I have faith that God knows what He's doing and work among the lepers. And please don't say that, oh, that cannot happen to any of us. That could happen to some of us, or one of us. When you have faith, you will do whatever God calls. God says, get baptized, you get baptized. And God says, pay your tithes, you pay your tithes. And God says, forgive, you forgive. Because you have faith, you believe that God knows that. When God says, give up debt, don't go there anymore. You don't go there anymore. And God says, that friendship is not good for you. Stop seeing that person. That's faith. Like how Asher will jump down the hill when mommy says, ask him to jump when he's two years old. That's faith. But we know, God, I think of my children. You know, if I do this, if I forgive, I can't buy it. We have 101 lousy reasons not to have faith. Because we think, we know better than God. But we don't. Say amen?
Amen.
We expect God to bless us. We expect God to answer our prayer. But God clearly says, unless you have faith, don't blame God. God gave you the key. Now you open the door. The key is prayer. Second prayer with faith. Say, God, why you never ask my prayer? You don't use the key. The key is key. Sorry, the key is key. The key is pray. Secondly, pray with faith. So we all have the key. Now what else do you want? You want God to come down from heaven and open the door for you? Let's turn to James chapter 2, please. Another key and complete. Pray, faith, another third one. Another key. And all they work together in unison as one. Just like the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, they are one. Prayer,
faith.
Let's start on the next one. James chapter 2, verse 17 to 19. Thus also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. Everyone say dead. So it's not enough to have faith, but we have to understand. Some people simply interpret this verse. Let's find out what this verse really means. I read that again. Faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. You need to have faith that is goes hand in hand with works. Who can say amen?
Amen.
I have faith in this chair. I have to work. I have to sit down. I have to move. That's work. Work means doing something. Responding, acting out, seeking, forgiving, serving. Don't be a lazy Christian. Move! Like I travel to KL every Wednesday. You think it's so cool? Sometimes I wake up, I'm not a morning person, I wake up at, I'm not bragging, but I'm not a morning person. I wake up at 7 o'clock sometimes, 8 o'clock to travel. Like this Wednesday, I'm taking the 8 o'clock morning bath, traveling down. I'm not a morning person. You got to do something. We have to move. We have to listen. God, what do you want me to do, Lord? What do you want me to do? Faith, there will be works. Come to church. Hallelujah. That's moving. I have faith, but you don't come to church. Why stay at home? My friend is more important than church. That's not faith. Leanne, you came all the way from JB. That's work. That's good works. Who can say amen?
Amen.
She was speaking to me and telling me her challenges. I said, come to church. I was just testing you. I hope you came. You came. I was just testing you. That's good works. She came. I'm coming. I said, I pray I see you. I'll come with my 5 children. So, wow, good. But my heart said, I'll wait and see. That's work. Who can say amen? Well, I believe, Pastor Ed. I believe, but you will not move your legs. You won't do anything. Come on. Jesus died on the cross. None of our work went from JB to Malaka. For me to wake up 7 o'clock and compared to the work of Christ. The work of Christ on the cross. He was stripped naked and died on the cross. That's the ultimate work any of us can say. We are. Our work is greater than His. Can you fetch that person to church? Oh, wait. One small work God is calling us to do. We have so many reasons not to work. Can you teach children's church? Can you come for helping these poor folks here? Please. It's time to wake up. I have quit teaching the handicapped children for so many years. But this year, the Lord Himself, the Holy Spirit prompted me, go back to Salvation Army and offer your service. And now, every week, once a week, I go there and teach the handicapped children. That's work. Who can say amen?
Amen.
And all of us are called to work, not just pastors. All. When you have faith, God's going to speak to you. God's going to speak to you. And respond. Quit making excuses, being lazy. Faith without works is dead. In other words, there is such thing as living faith and dead faith. Iman yang sudah mati atau iman yang masih hidup. Who can say amen?
Amen.
God is calling us to have iman yang hidup. Bukan iman yang sudah meninggal dunia. We believe. I believe, but we don't remove. We refuse to even lift one finger. Can you help in a TFT, Usher? No. Can you sell 5 tickets? I can give you hundreds of reasons, lah. how people who claim to have faith is removed to move. I want to see God's kingdom revealed. I want to evangelize, but one finger cannot lift up. That is dead faith. If you don't believe me, I'm telling you that's from the Bible. It's from the Bible now. This is not Pastor Edmund. The book of Pastor Edmund, chapter 2, verse 17. No, no, no. It's the book of James, chapter 2, verse 17 to 19. I didn't write this. God, the Holy Spirit inspired James to write. And who can say amen? Let me read to you again if you didn't get it earlier. Thus also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. You can have all the faith you want. If you're not ready to work, your faith is dead. Verse 18, but someone will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith without your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. Verse 19, you believe that there is one God, but you do well. Even the demons believe and tremble. In other words, what I'm trying to say, don't talk about belief. Even the demons believe, even the devil believe that God is great. But the devil does not do what they are supposed to do. Get it? Come on. Are you listening? What the Bible says, don't talk about your belief. Even the devil, even the demons believe that God is great. So what? You believe that God is great. You believe that God can heal. Even the demons believe that God can heal. Who? So what? But the difference between us and the demons is they believe, they know that God is great. They tremble, but they don't obey God. But we believe and we obey. And we have living faith. They have dead faith. Who can say amen? So it's no use to know, to believe, but do nothing, not responding, no use. So the three keys, pray, faith, work, amen. And don't just simply work. When we talk about work, we talk about what God wants you to do. For example, if Jeremy is praying for a new job, example, Jeremy said, I want a new job, Father, then he prayed. He had faith. Then God says,
apply.
Excellent example, apply. No, if you are God, you will just, the job will just appear from me. He has to work. Thank you, Jeremy. Apply. And it's not just your friend who will apply, it's about God. If God tells you don't apply, job will come and you don't apply. Works means you have to learn to listen to God and God will speak. That's why it's important to study the Word of God. Important to fellowship with Christians. Important to come to church. Important to have quiet time every day. And you will hear what God wants you to do. Say amen.
Amen.
So faith without works is dead. Get ready. If you are not ready to move, don't pray. If you're not ready to apply your job, in your case, the example, then don't ask God for a new job. Let's say if Ruby looking for a new husband.
Wow.
Okay, she's single anyway. She's single, so I'm looking for that. Well, she prays. She prays, and with faith, whoa, it's not here, but it's here. And God says, I want you to join that senior citizen club. Like, oh, well, I don't want. But I continue to pray. I mean, you pray and then you go into your grave when you listen to God. God says, go! There is a man there. I prepared him for you. But he didn't say that. He just says, go and join that club. But she doesn't get it. Why would that club? But she said, God wants to work. Work means move and join the club. She said, my job is to pray. Pray like you. So I do what you pray. Pray. You're going to move. Faith without work is dead. Amen.
Amen.
Oh God, I want to serve you in church. And God says, okay, from now on, wash the bathroom, don't mind. That's work. God is testing you. I want to preach, but one toilet you cannot wash for Jesus. You think you can preach for Jesus? No way. I want to do great things for Jesus. And God says, start now. Arrange the chairs every Sunday. Huh? What has every check got to do with preaching? You know better than God, or God know better than you. Faith without works is dead, I tell you, brothers and sisters. That's in the word of God. In other words, move your butts. Move your butts. Don't, if you're not ready to move, the end of the day, when your prayers don't get answered, you want your prayers to get answered? Pray to move! To serve! Then you pray! Then you ask! Because it's clear in the scriptures. Faith without works is dead. Amen? You want this, but you don't want to move. You don't want to walk. Stop praying. Don't blame God at the end of the day. So pray, faith, and work. And if you are walking with God closely, let me tell you this. Don't be afraid to work. Don't think that people abuse you, because God is for you. No one can be against you. Can say amen. You say, if I need to work, people abuse me. No, your God, He'll protect you. If I'm willing to work, then people will abuse me. No, don't worry. Your God, if you have that faith, you pray. I tell you, God will let nothing bad happen to you. Amen. Yes. Don't worry, you'll be powerful, abuse me, I can do everything. No. If you're walking closely with God, I tell you, God will walk on your side. God will slap your pastor's face. If your pastor is trying to abuse you and wanting you to work extra. And you're walking closely with God, you will hear from God. If God says, do that. If God says, wash the toilet of your church every week. And you're walking closely with God, you will hear the voice of God. You will be sure, because God is a perfect speaker. He's not gaga, thank you, God, I can't get the toilet. No, wash the toilet. Or teach the children. Or buy your pastor a nice present. if it's not from God, you will hear a nice present. But from God, you will hear, buy your pastor a nice present. And you don't get it, you will say it again. I said, buy your pastor a nice present. The point is, when God speaks, He speaks very clearly. You can say amen? Yeah. So you don't clear that door. It's not from God. Walk with closely with God and don't be scared. God will just lead me, lead you and lead me, lead each and every one of His children. He's a wonderful God. He's a good God. James chapter 2 verse 17 again. Let's read that again. Thus, also by faith, see by itself, it does not have worth, it is dead. Verse 18, but someone will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith without works and I will show you my faith by my works. Verse 19, you believe that there is one God, you do well, even the demons believe and tremble. So, believing is not enough. Tell your friend, believing only is not enough. Come on. Believing only is not enough. Get ready to move. That Jeremy said, get ready to go for that interview when God asks you to apply. Excuse me. It's God, get ready to work. And it's exciting to work for God. It's exciting. You see, wow, the fruits of working for God. What a blessing. It is beautiful. If God tells you to fetch someone, just fetch. Even in while you fetch that conversation, you're going to be, why, thank God I fetch. I obeyed God and fetch that person. Someone said, God says, go to the streets and just minister to the beggars on the street. Just go to, any of you done that? I've done that, not bragging, but I've really done that. Go to the streets alone, only partner, just alone. Partner, get great, like my example, I have gone to the streets alone, walk on the street, and God says, stop, why? Pray for that beggar. Whoa. If you follow my flesh, I don't like doing that. Because beggars are smelly. And I don't know what they're going to do. But I've done that a few times. My wife always say, don't use your example, I don't care, I'm going to use my example. I've done that many times. I stop when I am alone, stop at beggars, kneel down and ask for money. I said, I want to give you more than money, I want to give you prayer. So I laid my hands on them, pray, and then of course I end up with them a little money. But I want to give them something more than money. But that's what God wants. When you say, God, I want to serve you, stop. Pray for that beggar, stop. Visit the old folks, stop. Teach the handicapped, stop. Pick people up. Stop, be nicest person. That's works. Amen. Get ready to work, and I tell you, each time I walk away from a beggar, I walk away, wow, such a good feeling. And it's not about feelings, but the feeling is like, oh, thank you God for using me. me. I'm sure there's just a prayer, there's just 10 ringgit, there's just 5 ringgit, whatever it is. But I'm sure that something good has been downloaded into that man's spirit. You can say amen.
Amen.
One of my friends says, don't give to beggars, because they are just, there's all kinds of, you know, schemes and all that. Sometimes the Holy Spirit is bigger than, the Holy Spirit is definitely bigger than all the schemes and all these plans. Even that, let's say if that man really, not a real beggar, but he's a real soul. Who can say amen?
Amen.
Your prayer will do something in that person's life. Don't think too much. When God says, go. When God says, wait. When God says, serve. When God says, give. When God says, stop. That's work. Work. Get ready to work. And it's beautiful. Thank you, Jesus. Let's turn to John chapter 3, verse 7 to 8. Another beautiful verses. Thank you, Jesus. Are you being blessed?
Yes.
Diberkatina? Yes. You hear God's word, of course you're blessed. Amen. Amen. Unless your heart is heart of stone, then you know you want to hear what you want to hear, things that make you happy, then this church is not for you. This church will preach truth. We won't sugarcoat God's words. If God says A, it's A, not A with an icing on top. Are you listening?
Yes.
And that's a real church. That's a church you want to go to. Not you go to a church where they put, make all the, it sounds so nice, and make you go out feeling, ooh, so nice. I feel so good. Or you want to go to a church where you only hear God's word and God's word alone without a cherry on top. Say amen. So the strong ones will stay, the weak ones will have to go. Too bad for you. No one lose but you, you will lose, no one does. John chapter 3 verse 7 to 8, it says, do not marvel that I say to you, you must. Everyone say must.
Must
is not a choice, huh? This verse says you must. You must be born again. That's a real Christian. You must become a new person. That means you must dilahirkan semula. Dilahirkan semula. Sekali lagi. Okay, so you must. The word must is a very powerful word here. You must be born again. Not those who want, hands up, who want to born again, you can, but no. Every real person must be born again. It's in the scriptures. Verse 8, and it explains. This verse 8 explains, like giving an illustration of what it means to be born again. What it means. Okay, born again and what? Verse 8, the wind blows, it wishes, and you hear the sound, but you cannot tell what it comes from and where it's gone. So is everyone, say everyone,
everyone,
who is born of the Spirit. So when you are born again, you will be led by the Spirit. Get it? When you are born again, Balan, you are not led by your emotions. I do this because I feel. I do that because the person asked me to do. That's what it means. When you, first thing it says, you must be born again. Secondly, it says it becomes like how the wind moves. I'm going to give you a shot that it's staring at me. Look. He's staring at me. He's receiving in that spirit. Hallelujah. You know, you must be born again. And being born again is like the wind. You are led by the Spirit. No longer led by emotions. No longer led by intelligence. Led by logic. Let what I feel like that, I do. No, not how you feel. What the Spirit wants you to do. And everything the Spirit speaks is in the Word of God. You can say amen. That's why you need to read the Word of God. Because the Word of God and the Holy Spirit, the Spirit is the Holy Spirit, the same person. That is His Word. The more you read the Word of God, the more you'll be able to identify what the wind is telling you. Do that. Keep quiet. You are angry, shut up. He will tell you to keep quiet, to speak. Don't fight. Time to speak. Time to zip. Time to fast. It's like the wind will tell you. It's beautiful. He will blow. Go. Stop. Surrender. Humble. He you will lead back to win. But if you don't get born again, no way you can be led by the Spirit. No way. So it's not enough to have the Word of God. You must have the Spirit of God. Amen. Even the Muslim can hold the Bible. Do you know that? Even the Hindu can hold the Bible and read. Or the Buddhist can hold the Bible and read. But they don't have the Spirit. It's different. They are, to them, the Bible is just a book. But to real Christians, who are filled with the Spirit, when we read the Bible, the Holy Spirit is telling us, this is what I want you to do. This is what I teach you. He will interpret for you. He will tutor you. You will be led by the Spirit. It's different. So you must be filled by the Spirit. And it's not difficult. The Bible says, if you accept Jesus and you ask the Father, Father, give me your Holy Spirit, He will give you the Holy Spirit. Don't let anybody give you someone, you must do this, do that, do that. No. There's nothing about doing. It's about believing. That's why we are called believers. Christians are called believers. Who can say amen? I'm a believer. Do you hear the word? I'm a believer. Means I'm a Christian. So just believe. So if you have not asked the Holy Spirit to fill you, then ask Him. And then after that, every day ask the Holy Spirit to fill you. Every day. Refill me, Holy Spirit. That's what I do. Every morning I wake up and say, Holy Spirit, refill me. When I'm in church worshipping, I'm just worshipping. Refill me, Holy Spirit, once again. Refill me. Fill my cup, Lord. Fill you with what? Those verses like speaking about being filled by the Holy Spirit. And I've said this in this church before. I'm not sure how many of you are practicing that. Every day ask the Holy Spirit to refill you. And sometimes you will have tangible experience. You feel like, ooh, there's something on your hand. Don't be scared. Sometimes you don't feel anything. It doesn't matter. Sometimes you feel sweaty suddenly. You feel your head shaking. Don't be scared. It's all a manifestation. Sometimes you feel like something, a stone fell on your head. Zoom! All kinds of experience. I've experienced a lot of this. And it's a wonderful experience. But if you don't get your experience, it doesn't matter. But if you get it, don't be scared. So get the Holy Spirit to refill you every day. Amen. Then, but if you don't accept Jesus, you cannot ask the Holy Spirit to come. The Holy Spirit cannot come into those who don't accept Jesus. If you accept Jesus, why is it like that? When you accept Jesus, you also accept His blood. When you accept Jesus, the blood of Jesus washes you. So what? Big deal. When the blood of Jesus washes you, you become righteous, you become holy. Say, I'm holy. When you become holy, then only Holy Spirit can come. But you don't have Jesus, you are not holy. Because when you don't have Jesus, you don't want Jesus, the blood of Jesus cannot wash you. Are you following? You have Jesus, the blood washes you, you become holy. So you become holy, then only Holy Spirit comes. Holy Spirit can't wait to come inside each and every one of you. Wait, I don't want Jesus. He cannot come. He doesn't want, I cannot come inside of Him. Holy Spirit is just waiting to come. And you become holy not because of what you do or what you don't do. You become holy through Jesus' blood that cleanses you. Amen. And then the Holy Spirit comes, then you start doing. Get filled first, then start doing. Don't try to do good things without the leading of the Holy Spirit. You are just like anyone else who don't have Christ. You are doing good. And even, let me tell you, even non-Christians are doing the best good works out there. Hello, I have friends, Hindu, Buddhist, Muslim, they are doing fantastic good works. They don't need Jesus to do that. You can say amen.
Amen.
Come on, are you listening? But it's different, but they are led by their emotions. But when you as a believer, you do good things, you are being led by the Spirit. And when you're led by the Spirit, your good works will never go wrong. But when you do good works, not because of the Holy Spirit, I want to be kind, I want to help the handicapped children. And the end of one of the possibilities, your hip can become big, people praise you. What happened? You're so good, huh? You help the handicapped. Huh? But now I know, let me tell you, I'm helping the handicapped or whoever I'm helping. It's not me. It's nothing to do with me. It's not because I'm good. Because the Holy Spirit asked me to do. And He gave me the strength and the patience. So if anybody say, well, good choice, it's not me. Hallelujah, praise. What's the name of hallelujah? Hallelujah means praise Jesus. Amen. It's not me. The Holy Spirit filled me. He asked me to help the handicapped children. I just don't help. Without Him, I won't even do. Who cares about handicapped children? Are you listening? Why do I get time to come and preach here every Sunday? Because the Holy Spirit leads me to preach to you. Not because I'm so good. Trust me, I'm not that good. I do a lot of good things, and the good things I do is not because of me. I'm not a good person. It's the Holy Spirit who is good, who has filled me and is using me. And that's the way who can say amen. So if people praise me, they cannot praise me. I say, it's not me, it's Him. It's Him. He is the one. He is the good one. I'm just an instrument, the Kayu. And that's how it's supposed to be with every real Christian. You are blown like the wind. Do all kinds of good things. And I cannot praise myself for nothing. It's Him. In fact, I'm blessed to be used by Him. You are blessed if God used you. We don't deserve to be used by God. Amen? All the ugly things we have done in the past, you have done and I have done in the past, all the bad things we have done. But yet, God is saying, I'm willing to use you today. I'm willing to send my Son to wash you, get you start all over again. All of us have a second chance. So every good thing we do, our finger has to go up. It's God. It's God. Hallelujah. Let's turn to another verse, please. Let's turn to John chapter 14. Probably may have to close with this one. Even though I just preached like half of my sermon.
It's okay. Excuse me. I believe that God's message has been brought forward.
John chapter 14 verse 25 to 27. And after this you're going to pray. Pray for everyone who needs to be prayed. The word of God says this in John chapter 14 verse 25. These things I have spoken to you while being present with you. But the helper, everyone say the helper. Say the helper. The helper here is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, yes, pembantu. He comes and help you. You need the Holy Spirit. You have the Holy Spirit to fill you. But before that, accept Jesus first. Okay? Verse 26. But the helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, He will teach you. He becomes your Jago. He becomes your teacher. He will teach you all things. And bring to your remembrance all things I say to you. That you have read the Bible 10 years ago, that part there, the time, the right time, the Holy Spirit will remind you what you read 10 years ago. The Holy Spirit will remind you everything that you have read, everything that you heard in church, everything that your friend told you about Jesus. That when you have the Holy Spirit, He will just take that memory and remind you. And then it sounds like you become so clever. Oh, he said, what? You're so clever. He said, no, it's not me, it's the Holy Spirit who told me to do it. He will bring into remembrance everything that once upon a time you heard Jesus told you. Or the pastor told you about Jesus. Or you read it in the Bible. Read that again, verse 26. But the helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, He will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things I said to you. 27. Then only peace I give with you. When you have the Holy Spirit, you have peace. Say amen.
Amen.
So you want peace? Let me tell you, real peace money cannot buy. You think when you want peace, go holiday, you get peace. Trust me, if you go holiday, you get more headache. Well, I want peace, I want more money. You get more money, more headache. It's good to go for holidays, little blessing. It's good to get more money, but the real peace comes from the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah, but the Bible says so. And I can testify to that. Verse 27, peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Hallelujah, God is good, amen. Are you blessed?
Yes.
Yes, I'm blessed preaching the truth. And I hope that you are blessed listening to the truth. So let's all rise up. Can I have Vivian to just strum the guitar for us? And I have two people to just put this on the side, help me, whoever, come.